So we're in a series called The Men, where we are looking at men of the Bible, men of the scriptures. We are looking at obscure ones because that's just how we roll here. I don't want to do anything the normal way. That would be too easy. So we're looking at the cat named Jude. All we really know from Jude is what we get in Jude's book, okay? So Chris just read to you the whole book of Jude, and I have limited time this morning, as always, and I have so much to teach. I always hate the fact that I only get an hour with you, and I wish I had more time. So I am going to skip any pleasantries. I'm going to skip anything that can lead us off topic, and I just want to get right into teaching. Is that good? Here's what we're going to do, so stay with me. I'm going to give you, I'm going to teach the introduction, all right? Then I'm going to give you 3 points that that have been laid in my heart to pull out from characteristics revealed to us through the book of Jude about the man Jude, okay? So we're going to get 3 things that we can apply to ourselves from his life, and I'm going to spend a little bit of time before we even get into the main teaching just to look at his introduction, because in the introduction, we're going to find some amazing things that reveal how our Creator views his creation, okay? I think it's a good way to start. So let's just jump right into the beginning. The introduction to Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ, the brother of James, to those who have been called, who are loved in God, the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Jude opens his letter with a standard format, okay? He states who he is, and who he is writing to, and then he follows it by a typical Christian greeting. This opens like most letters would read from a first century Christian to a church. They all kind of have the same format. There's an introduction to the person who is writing. He says who he is. Okay, we can read the epistles that Paul writes or other ones. There's always, hey, here's who I am. Greeting, here's who you are. And then we move into the body of the letter and why we're writing. Now, it's so standard format that as you read the scriptures, you're going to start noticing that this is the exact format that every single letter is structured with in the beginning. You get so used to it that when you become familiar, it becomes common and you gloss over it. And we are prone to do that, okay? We just gloss over it, let me get to the meat. But see, if we gloss over this introduction, we miss something absolutely amazing. Because this introduction, unlike a lot of them, is profound, church. It is amazing. I could teach a whole sermon series, no joke, 3 sermons just on the introduction because of what is brought out of it. And I struggled to say, what direction do I go this week as I was in prayer about it? Because as I continued to study just this part, I'm like, Lord, there's so much. So I'm going to do my best just to kind of skip the portion where he introduces himself. That's going to be one of our 3 points. And instead, I just want to move to the portion where he addresses who he's writing to. And that is this. You notice he says, I am writing to those who have been called, who are loved, and to those who are kept. Called, loved, and kept. What an amazing way to open our teaching this morning, right? But even more so, what an amazing way for people to be addressed. Jude rightly moves past his titles with very little fanfare, and trust me, Jude has so many titles he could use, but he lavishes the most beautiful title upon his readers, and he addresses them as the called, the loved, and the kept. Church, if you are in Christ this morning, this is your title. And that is good news because many of us, when we were called, we were not much according to the world. When many of us were called to God, we did not have much stature, we did not have much status, we did not have much prestige. But know that today, for those of you who are in Christ, the most glorious titles that could ever be lavished upon a person is yours, and that is you are the called, you are the loved, and you are the kept. Okay. And we're jumping right into the deep end, so I want you to just try to get with me here and get into the vibe of this. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them up to Jude. If you don't know where it is or your apps on your phone, it's even easier. But basically, go to the last book, which is the book of Revelation, and then take a left-hand turn. The next book is Jude. Stay there. That's where we're going to be at this morning. So Jude opens this morning, and he tells his audience, I understand the audience, the called, loved, the kept, these are believers, okay? So if you today are a follower of Christ, if you're a believer in Jesus, this letter can be very aptly and very accurately accurately applied to you with not a lot of having to go back and look at culture and context. It's pretty straightforward, okay? So he says here, first off, that you are the called. The Greek word here is kletos. Kletos means called, it means invited, it means summoned by God to an office or to salvation. I don't know, that didn't hit home like I needed to. Let me say that again. He's calling us, his audience, the called, and that Greek word means invited or summoned by God to an office or to salvation. Church, that should floor you. That really should floor you. If you fully understand that you were called by God to salvation, that should floor you, because nobody wakes up, all right, just stay with it. Nobody wakes up one day and says, you know what, I am just going to follow Jesus today. We are too depraved by our own sin nature to even make that good decision without the Holy Spirit initiating it for us. Right. Nobody just wakes up and says, I'm just going to be a Christian today. I think I'm going to respond. We're too dead in our sins to do that. So the concept that the creator of the universe calls you, pursues you, invites you, that should floor you. The initiation of the call begins with God pursuing and calling you. If that doesn't make your mind explode, okay, let me just kind of break it down and explain it this way. The creator of the entire universe, the creator of time, space, and matter, the one who has no beginning, no end, the one who sits on a throne to judge the whole world and all of eternity, chose you. I didn't even get choose for kickball. I don't know, because you're really awkward and uncoordinated. But God chose you. If you were in Christ, God chose you. I'm good with that. I wasn't chosen by a lot of people in this life, but God chose me. I can hang my hat on that. Let me read you. Jesus said in John chapter 6, verse 44, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. See, God pursues. God initiates. God instigates. He starts this whole process. You're dead in your sins. You can do no good. God draws you. Jesus continues in Matthew 22, many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. So who are chosen? Who are the chosen? Well, those are those of us who have faith in Christ. Those of us who have been saved by God. Those of us who are believers in Jesus. We are the chosen. They are those of us who respond. And I think that's a great way to put it. See, God is sovereign, yet each of us has a responsibility to respond to the calling. See, God pursues you. God calls you. But you have a responsibility as mankind to respond to that pursuit, okay? Each of us has a responsibility to respond to that free gift of grace. So you are the called, then he says you're the beloved. The Greek in this case is the word for agape or agapeo, which means I love or I wish well to, I take pleasure in or I long for. So he's saying you are the beloved, you are the loved, you are the longed for, you are the desired in God. Some of you need to hear that this morning. I should say some of us need to hear that. Because we don't really feel that way, do we? Maybe you're like, I'm in a great relationship right now, I feel loved. A lot of us, that's a thing that we're searching for. And to know that God longs for you, the King of the universe takes pleasure in you, that he has called you to him, he has initiated a relationship fully on his end, solely because you're good enough? No. Solely because you worked hard? No. Solely because you deserve it? No, not at all. Solely because he desires you. You have a God who pursues, who initiates when you ignore, and then loves when you rebel. Doesn't love when you rebel, but he loves you in your rebellion. That makes sense? Find a human that does that. Yeah. Find a spouse that does that. Find a boyfriend, a girlfriend, a friend who does it. You will not. Lastly, he wraps up his lavish title to his audience that we can put on us by saying he calls them the kept. Now, I mean, it seems odd. You may say, you know, beloved, I get that. I love that. Called, I see the beauty in that, Pastor Kevin. kept? How is this a great thing to be kept? Well, when you understand who you are kept for, it's pretty awesome. See, you are kept for Jesus, and the Greek word here for kept stems from a word that means guarded, preserved, or kept intact. That means you are guarded for Christ, preserved for Christ, and kept intact for the glory of Christ. Church, if you are in Christ, then hear this. You need not worry about your eternal security anymore. Let me reinforce this. I have the wrong verse up here, but Philippians chapter 1, verse 6 says this, I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will see it through to completion on the day of Jesus. See, if God initiates salvation in you, if he is the one that initiates the pursuit of you, if he's the one saying, that's my beloved, I love them, I desire them, I am pursuing them, I am calling them, they are my chosen, and we respond, that if he initiates it, that he has the power to sustain it and to keep you. So your eternal security should be steadfast. This idea of saying, man, did I lose it today? No. Did my sin blot it out? No. You are called, you are beloved, and if you are in Christ, he who has called you has the power to sustain you, and he will keep you. Your job, your role, is simply to stay firmly in the love of God. And that's one of our points. I'm going to get to that here in a little bit this morning. So we opened the scriptures this morning, and that's just the intro, and there's so much there. And as we gather together as a church family, which I'm so blessed that we get to do, Jude poetically paints this picture of who we are. So as you sit in your seats, as you prepare to just ingest more of the scripture, understand that you are sitting here, if you were in Christ, and you are called. You are beloved. And you are kept. So sit in that beautiful painting that Jude gives us. Sit in that beautiful title. And then prepare yourself to feast on the rest of God's word that was clearly laid out for our benefit this morning. It's a beautiful place to be in. Now to my non-Christian friends that are here this morning, this is just as much this title. While it is a title for believers, it is also an invitation for you. If you are not in Christ this morning, understand that the call, the love, the kept, this is an invitation for you to trade in the labels, the titles that the world has put on you, that maybe you've put on yourself. And in your shame and in your pride, you have identified as something wrong. And this is an invitation for you to live a new transformed life in Christ as someone who is called, someone who is beloved, someone who is kept. And that's a wonderful invitation this morning. So let's jump right into the meat of what Jude's talking about. Because I know as Crystal graciously read God's word this morning, it could seem a little bit confusing. I'm not going to teach it verse by verse. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try to just pull out what we can see about Jude, and we're going to try to learn some, at least three big lessons from this morning. And when he starts out, if you have your Bibles, if you have your apps, and they're open to Jude, understand that something unique happens here. See, Jude has a personal desire to write about the joy of salvation and Jesus they all have in common. That's why, if you look at the very beginning, it says, I intended to write to you about our common salvation. We all have salvation in common. I wanted just to write to talk about it because it was awesome. Like, that's one of my favorite things to talk about. I just talk about Jesus. Talk about my salvation. I can't blame you. He's like, I was really excited to write to you about this. But see, here's the thing. As with all scripture, it is not man's words that we have here, but the words we have here are the words of the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit, inspired through man and preserved for us today. Okay? So the Holy Spirit, what happens is the Holy Spirit placed upon Jude's heart a greater need for the believers to hear about something different. As we hear in verse 3, he says, I wanted to write to you about our common salvation. I can't. I'm writing to you to contend for our faith. So the Holy Spirit puts on Jude's heart this greater need to have his listeners hear about the need to contend for the faith, and then the Holy Spirit, in his grace, places upon the mind of Jude the words which God intends for him to write, because all Scripture is God-breathed and inspired. Okay. So the purpose of this letter is revealed in verse 3, and that is, I'm ready to have you contend for your faith. And the reason for that is in verse 4. He goes, because there's a lot of garbage teachers that are coming into the body, and they're spewing a lot of crap to you guys, and people are starting to believe it. So that's why I'm doing it, and here's what I want you to hear, and here's what I was going to do, which I don't get to do. That's the whole basis for the letter. Make sense? Up and down, north and south, you're with me, right? You're like, that's makes okay, I get it. Why didn't it just say that? Well, it did. You just got to slow down and read it, right? Okay? So Jude goes into great detail after this, and this is kind of where oftentimes our eyes and our ears gloss over as the word is read. But he goes into great detail the next portion, next 12, 13 verses, explaining the consequences of rebelling and following false teachers throughout the history of Israel. So as we read this morning, and you might have heard different names, you're like, I don't remember that part, I don't really know what that is. Jude is basically saying, listen, you guys know your history, you're not stupid. Here are a whole bunch of examples of when people did dumb things, and they followed false teachers, and they rebelled. And then here's the consequence of rebellion, and here's what the wrath of God looked like. And then he goes even farther, he starts talking about individuals. And saying, learn from it. People who don't remember their history are doomed to repeat it. Yes? Amen? And so Jude's like, don't be stupid. Remember this, right? Then he goes on to give a very clear, concise explanation of what it means to contend for the faith, which I will describe to you very clearly. And then after that, he closes with the most beautiful doxology that's ever been recorded in the Scriptures. The most beautiful blessing, which we get to close with this morning. That's just something that I will find myself as a young pastor going back to year after year to read as like ointment to a weary soul. So along the way, as we unfold Jude's writing, three things I feel led to highlight this morning. The first one is his identity as a man of faith. That's applicable, right? If you're not a man, if you're a woman, still the same thing, okay? All right? I'm going to speak in the masculine. The second point that we see today, his, Jude's, understanding of the faith. And lastly, we're going to close with his call for everyone to contend for the faith. So those are the three big things, and I want to just jump right into it. Let's start with point one, okay? His identity as a man of faith. I mentioned when I began this morning that in the standard opening of Jude's letter, we see one of our points emerge from the way he introduces himself. I kind of touched on that, so now let's revisit that, okay? If we look at your Bibles, you look at your apps, if you look at God's Word, begin of Jude, very first couple of verses, stay with me here. He says this, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. Now, if you go too quick, you miss it, don't you? You should say it again. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. When we read the Scriptures too fast, we miss it. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all Scripture is God-breathed and useful or profitable for correcting, teaching, rebuking, training up in all righteousness. What that means, church, is it means slow down and listen. If all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for you, then don't you think you should slow down and stop reading it like it's a Stephen King novel or Harry Potter? I can't wait to see what happens at the end. No, it's not. That's not how it is. Every single word that you have in the beautiful Scriptures in front of you is a word that God intended for you to hear. Every single stroke of the pen is God in his beautiful creativity revealing his characteristics and his nature to us so that we can better understand him, his will, and our response to his revelation. So where do we start getting off thinking we're just going to blow through and figure out what's the point? You're missing God's words. Okay? He says, hey guys, I'm Jude, I'm James' brother. That's paraphrasing, although I think the Message Bible kind of says it like that. But we see here Jude is very willing in this initial opening. He identifies himself very willingly as the brother of James. Does that freak anybody out? Let me see where you're going with that. I think I know. Can I get a top off of my coffee? Jude identifies himself as a brother of James. Now, if we know from Scripture as well, thank you, Jose, as well as from history. James, open up, stay with me. James is the half-brother of Jesus. His parents were divorced. It's not like his half-brother. Okay? Half-brother because...
Different
fathers. There you go. Different daddies, right? Different dads. He's a half-brother of... Well, he's a brother of James, and James is a half-brother of Jesus. So that makes Jude a half-brother of Jesus as well. So the book of Jude is written by Jesus' half-brother. Anybody think what I'm thinking? Why not lead with that? Right? Like, why isn't that the first thing you wrote down? Hey guys, I'm Jude, I'm Jesus' brother, so, you know, I'm kind of a big deal. You should listen to what I have to say, because, you know, Jesus, we're like this. But it's interesting to notice that when he's telling the people who he is, my man is completely and totally unwilling to identify himself by that relationship to Jesus. He's like, I ain't gonna touch that. I like that. Like, he has no desire to make that comparison that he shares the DNA of Jesus, that he's that familiar in a family setting. More than likely, he feels uncomfortable even putting himself on that level, lest people make him more than he is, as the Catholics did with Mary, right? It's easy for us to elevate people to a level higher than what they are. He doesn't even identify himself like this, lest maybe even he believe himself to be anything more than just a simple man. He's keeping himself and his pride in check. I'm just James's brother, a servant of Jesus. And that's how he identifies himself. The only relationship to Jesus that he's willing to say he has is as a slave. That's what a servant is. It's a bond servant. It's a slave. He's like, yeah, I have a relationship with Jesus. Aren't you his brother? I'm a slave. That's as close as I'll get to saying who I am in Christ. I'm a slave. I'm a servant to him. Man, he rightly understands and views Jesus as not one to be compared to in such a common, familiar way, but he accurately sees Jesus as the living Word of God, the Word made flesh, God incarnate. And he's like, I revere that. And I just want to understand, I'm James' brother. I'm Jesus' slave and servant. Now let's go back to the fact that he was by birth the half-brother of Jesus, because I think we just need to let that sink in. I don't know if we fully grasp what that must be like. Right? Like, talk about having inadequacy issues, right? Can't you be more like your brother? Come on! And I understand, like, they didn't really, these guys, they weren't like these powerful, awesome guys that were like, my brother's the Messiah. They actually thought he was crazy at times. Even Mary was like, hey, go get your brother. He's out there being all Jesus-y. Like, they even rejected him at a time. Now, we know that they go on to James lead the Jerusalem church and Jude to be a passionate servant. But can you imagine what it's like to be able to have the title of half-brother of Jesus? People love to name drop nowadays, don't they? People love name dropping. And I actually see this a lot in the Christian world, which you wouldn't expect, but people love to name drop in the Christian world. And I see a lot of young believers or young pastors who they have maybe a friend or an acquaintance with a famous Christian speaker or author, and they love to, because of that little acquaintance that they've made with them, they'll trump it up a little bit, right? People do this, all right? Like, yeah, you met that person once and they shook your hand and they don't know who you are, and you're like, no, we talk all the time now. Like, we were texting this morning. No, you weren't. You and John Piper weren't having gelato at the Together for the God conference. It wasn't happening, you know, Together for the Gospel conference. It wasn't happening. And even if you were hanging out having gelato with John Piper, who is just an amazing man of God, so what? So what if you were? See, people love to name drop and feel more important about who they are because of who they know, but even if you do know that person, they're a good friend of yours, so what? Because at the end of the day, even though these men are being used by God for amazing things, even though God is using these men in amazing ministries, at the end of the day, these cats are simply fallen sinners saved by the grace of God. No different than us. They're just being used in a different manner. But here, we got a guy who doesn't just know or is friendly with some famous Christian speaker. He shares DNA with Jesus. He grew up playing as kids with the person, God in flesh, who existed before time. The one who was there at the foundation of the earth was hanging out, running around the house with him. That's who he grew up with. That's who he lived with. Yet he still identifies himself simply as a servant, not even willing to take that familiarity. Now, I would just think, like, imagine, put yourself in that scenario. Put yourself in Jude's shoes, okay? Imagine if you had that background, that pedigree. Imagine if you had that family tree. And consider then if you would have that type of restraint. Consider, would you have the humility to do the same thing that Jude did? There is a scene from a well-respected classic film of cinematic history in Hollywood by the name of Anchorman.
Oh, yeah.
And in this movie, I believe that there's a scene from it that captures the response that many of us might have if we were in Jude's shoes. And let me just refresh your memory.
Do you know who I am?
No, I can't say that I do.
I don't know how to put this, but I'm kind of a big deal.
Really?
People know me.
Like, I'm not saying that we might actually say that out loud, but I believe while externally we might fringe humility, internally many of us might have those same thoughts, wouldn't we? You don't know who I am? People know me. Right? I know it would be difficult for me. My greatest sin is pride. That is the one that has tripped me up many times in my life. That's my greatest weakness. So for me, I feel that I would struggle with being the half-brother of Jesus. That would be a difficult thing for me. But Jude nails it. And I want to be like Jude. Because Jude rolls up, and when presented with the opportunity to brag, he's like, who, me? I'm nobody. But the person I serve, he's kind of a big deal. I'm just trying to be a reflection of him. I think that's awesome. This is the definition of humility, but even more so, that is the definition of what it means to have a right understanding of our place in light of who God is. It is a right understanding that our place is that of a submissive servant to Jesus. That's what Jude is showing to us, just in the way he introduces himself. That makes you really rethink the way you introduce yourself now, doesn't it? Like, we just preach for like 20 minutes on how someone introduces themselves to others. I'll tell you, you can learn a lot about a person by the way they introduce themselves to you. What do they lead with?
Me.
It's a pleasure to know me. Right? Jude's like, it's a pleasure to know Jesus. Oh, man, it's cool. He knows his place as a man who lives under the authority of Jesus. He knows his place as someone who lives in submission to Jesus. He understands that he is called to serve God's will, not his own. And friends, if you want to know why many people hate the gospel, that's why. He knows his role, his proper role, a right understanding of our role is to live in submission as a servant to Christ. And that is why people hate the gospel. See, Jesus says, let me explain. If you want to understand why people are repulsed by the gospel, it's because the gospel calls mankind, who is rebellious by nature, to submit to ultimate moral authority. Let me say that again. The reason why people are repulsed by the gospel is the gospel calls you to submit. And we are rebellious by nature. Don't act like you know you're not. Right? We're rebellious people. The gospel says submit. People say that's repulsive. And this is what Jesus says in the gospels. He says, "For wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, many enter through it. But small is the gate, narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it." See, there is a road that we are called to walk down, but it is narrow. And as we walk through that road, there's a gate that is very narrow. And as you walk through this gate, there's paradise in front of you. There's eternity with God, but you have to be willing to fully submit and come under total authority to walk down that road. That's a tough thing for a lot of us to swallow. Many, many people are offended by the idea of submission. We live in a culture that boasts of being, and I see it in, as I've ventured in the fitness world as we do ministry there, everybody wants to grind and call themselves self-made. Nowadays, everybody wants to be self-made. They want to be in control of their own future. They want to be in control of their own destiny. They love saying that, you know, "I will speak my life into existence." Okay. We live in a culture where people want to be their own boss, do what they want, feel what they want, live how they want, think how they want, love how they want, identify how they want, express how they want. And when you tell that culture that Jesus is calling you to die to yourself, die to your wants, die to your will, and fully submit to Him, daily live under His authority, you're going to find yourself hated, lonely, and without a date for Valentine's Day. Ain't nobody going to like that. They're like, "Well, you're an ignorant bigot. And you're closed-minded." Right? John Calvin says this. Smart old dead dude. "It is bad to live under a prince who permits nothing, but much worse to live under one who permits everything." Right? Do you catch that? It's bad to live under a prince who permits nothing, but it's even worse to live under someone who permits everything. Why is this? Because man's unsatisfiable hunger to fill their lives with their own desires will ultimately lead to their destruction. I'm going to say that again. The desire that men have, it's unsatisfiable. And when given into man's own free will, when man allows himself to live freely under his own reign, seeking after, thirsting after all of his wants and all of his desires, he will continue to come up empty, and that will lead to his destruction. He will find himself facing the throne of God with great emptiness and sorrow. See, submission to Christ, though, it's not living under a prince who permits nothing. It's not bondage to rules, all right? That's not what it is. When you live under submission to Christ, it's living under glorious rules and guidance that come from a loving King who wants you to see a life of joy and freedom. And in His wisdom, and let's be really clear, God's wisdom makes our wisdom look stupid. Our best wisdom is foolishness compared to God's wisdom. So God, in His wisdom and in His love for us, He does establish moral absolutes. He does give us what I would call guardrails. Things that keep us alive. I hate all these rules we have to follow. They're there to keep you from screwing up and killing yourself. All right? I want to live freely. Well, when you say freely, what you really mean is I want to live in bondage to sin. I want to live in bondage to my addictions. I want to live in bondage to my own selfish desires. You will find that that will lead to unsatisfaction. It'll lead to emptiness. See, He gives His commands as these wonderful guardrails that keep us from going off that cliff. I don't want your rules. You need them. They're keeping you alive. And when you, let me tell you, church, I've lived, as the world would say, freely, right? It destroyed me and hurt others. Even as a believer in Christ, even as a pastor, there have been seasons of my life where I have wanted to live freely, and I've acted on my own free will, and it hurt others, and it broke my heart. The most joy I have ever experienced in my life, and I promise you, the greatest joy you will ever experience is when you are living in the confines of God's will, submitting to His authority. You will not ever experience a far greater joy than that. Joy doesn't come from chasing your own desires. Joy comes when we are fully submitted to God and living for His glory. That is fully satisfying. second point that we see here. Jude has a great understanding of real faith, and we don't have a lot of information about the life of Jude. Most of what we hear about is he's a follower of Christ. We see it by examining his letter. But when we read through, it's obvious that this is a man who has a very firm foundation, a very firm understanding of the faith. Paul is a great theologian. If you read Paul's letters, church, you're going to find that he has a great grasp of what we call systematic theology. Jude don't have that, but Jude does know what real faith is. And for us today, I think it's good for us to have an understanding of the faith. Because I don't know if we all fully grasp what real faith is. Or maybe sometimes we need a refresher, right? The reason I feel compelled to focus on this part of Jude is because it's extremely applicable to us today. Because it is something that, when improperly understood, leads many people to live lives with false hope and false assurance. And here's what I mean. If you ask a large cross-section of the American culture if they have faith, you'd be surprised. Most Americans do have a faith. Most do. Absolutely. Most Americans do have a faith. Most will say, yeah, we have a faith, and it might be like in a higher power. Most people have a faith in something, whether it be a faith in karma, a faith in humanity, a faith in themselves. A faith in some weird blend of every major world religion that actually contradicts themselves, and you know these people because they have the coexist bumper sticker, which doesn't really mean coexist. It actually means that you're intolerant if you don't believe and accept every single person's point of view on life and what they believe. Going off on a tangent. Other people might say, yeah, we have a faith, but it's a faith in Jesus. Now, the latter, or I should say the former, doesn't concern me. People that have these weird hodgepodge of faith and some cosmic karmic balance. Because I know where they're at. The ones who concern me are those who say they have a faith in Jesus. Because today in the Western world, when people say they have a faith in Jesus, that can be very ambiguous and vague, can't it? A lot of people today say, oh, I have faith in Jesus, I'm good. I'm like, are you really? Your Jesus looks more like the genie Aladdin than it does the real Jesus of the Bible. Like, your Jesus looks more like some weird guru doing yoga with Toms on, shopping at Whole Foods, than the real Jesus, right? These are the ones that kind of concern me. Because, see, for some, they simply will have just cognitive knowledge of the big story. Okay? They have a cognitive knowledge. I have faith in Jesus. And their faith is just basically a cognitive knowledge of the large story. That there is a God who is a creator God. Man rebelled, mankind rebelled, the world fell in sin. God worked through a chosen people group to bring about the Savior of the world. Through Jesus, who is God incarnate, there was an atonement made for the sins that reconciled man to God. The resurrection shows that then Christ conquers death and provides a way for man to be reconciled. And they have this cognitive knowledge. So they feel pretty good, but as I've said many, many times behind this pulpit, cognitive knowledge, even a belief that the cognitive knowledge is real, is not saving faith. Knowledge is not saving faith. You can have all the knowledge in the world. You can know it inside and out. You can even know it to be true, but just a cognitive knowledge of things, that doesn't save us at all. Tell me about cognitive knowledge. Say, great, you got it. Yeah, good Sunday school teacher. But if that's all it is, that's just dead religion. Dead religion doesn't do anybody any good. I hate dead religion. Jesus hated dead religion. Jesus called them names. For some, they have a faith or a belief that Jesus was a real historical person. I meet these people a lot. They even have a firm understanding or a belief that he is God in flesh, but they don't hold to every word written in the scriptures. You ever meet these people? They're like, I do believe in Jesus. I think he was misunderstood. Like, okay, tell me about that, chief. They're like, he didn't really say these things. People have kind of misunderstood and twisted it around. And you know, I don't believe all of this is really God's word. Some of it was written by people with really good intentions. And it's more just like a moral good story to follow. But, you know, I believe in Jesus. Just, you know, they kind of messed it up in the Bible. Like, listen. The moment you separate Jesus, who is called the living word, from the word, you don't have Jesus anymore. Like, the moment you take the guy who's called the Word in flesh and you separate him from God's holy words, you got bootleg Jesus. Bootleg Jesus doesn't do any good. Bootleg Jesus doesn't save you. Bootleg Jesus just makes you feel good at peace pipes things at Burning Man. All right? It's useless. Okay? Lastly, the scariest group is the people who believe in Jesus as Savior. They believe every word in the Scriptures is God-breathed, but they've never fully committed to the act of making Him Lord. They're kind of like people with cognitive knowledge. They understand Him as Lord over everything, just not Lord over me and my situation. Lord over everything. He's real here. I believe in that. But He doesn't have the authority over my life. Because I'm going to do my thing. I'm going to recognize Him. I'm going to praise Him. I understand that, you know, He has everything, but I'm just going to kind of live as a rebellious child. Like, that don't save you either. That's not saving faith. These are the people, these are the poor souls that Christ says will cry out to Him in the last day, saying, Lord, Lord, didn't we do mighty works in Your name? And He says, depart from me, I didn't know you. Jude, as we see, he has an understanding of faith, a right, proper understanding of the faith. He knows what constitutes real faith. He had a knowledge of the breadth and the depth of the gospel. He understood that it's supposed to be a full commitment that needs to be taken to heart and lived out. He understands everything that goes with that. Give me just a snapshot of what he understands to be the real faith. Jude understands the character and nature of God. He understands that God is holy, just, and righteous, as well as graceful, loving, and merciful. That duality a lot of people don't like. Like, I like a loving Jesus. There's also a holy, just one. I like the grace Jesus. There's also one that hates sin. The whole character and nature of God. He gets that. He understood that man is depraved by nature, that we are sinful, that we are wicked, we are deserving of punishment. He understood that no amount of good deeds, no amount of effort or work can save a man from himself, right? Living freely is living in bondage. He understood rightly that only through a perfect Savior can man have any hope for reconciliation. And then he also understands the full work of Jesus. See, Jesus had a full work. He understood that Jesus offered himself up as a sacrifice to the Father on our behalf. He understood that on the cross the full weight of all sin was laid upon him. He understood that on the cross the full wrath of God was poured out. He understood that the resurrection of Jesus showed that only God can take the wrath of God and survive. He understood that death no longer holds power over man if man follows and submits to Jesus. And lastly, Jude understands that faith without works is dead. That real faith is a faith that has fruit. I can't judge your soul, but I should be able to open up my scriptures and do what it says, which is observe a man and be able to say, is there fruit being produced? Because if there is real faith, if there's a transformed life, there should be something that shows it. If you're walking all the time beating puppies, angry at everybody, flipping people off in traffic, you know? Well, you're just an angry Christian, but like, you should have fruit being produced from your life, right? And he gets that. He understands that real faith multiplies not just in the life of the individual, but outside with people. Jude has a good understanding of what the faith is. Lastly, we're going to wrap up with point three. I'm going to take us a couple minutes over this one. And this one's a pretty short one. But point three is Jude. We see from his life his call to contend for the faith. Contending, if you don't know what that word means, it can be defined a couple different ways. One way of what contend means is to expend effort in a noble cause. Okay? Expend effort in a noble cause. Let me give you a great example of what that means. When I was 10, I would daily contend with my mother for the benefit of toaster strudels over Pop-Tarts. Right? Like, I would have passionate pleas to contend for us buying toaster strudels over Pop-Tarts. And as a 10-year-old, that was the most noble cause I had in my life at the time. Some of you guys get my struggle, right? You know what that is, right? Fun fact, not only do Pop-Tarts suck compared to toaster strudels, but they have a new flavor of Pop-Tart which I believe is just evil, it's unfrosted Pop-Tart. Like, the worst part of a Pop-Tart is the crust. You just made a whole Pop-Tart of crust. Like, what kind of sorcery is this? Like, that's, no, that's, that shows the depravity of man fully, right? See, I worked Jesus into that. You didn't think I could do it. All right, let's finish this message, okay? But Jude here is writing for us to contend for what? He says, contend for the faith. And church, I can think of nothing in life that would be more worthy of our time, our energy, or our resources than to contend for our faith. There is nothing more noble to pursue than contending for the faith. Remember, the church is being attacked, so he's saying contend for it. And we understand the gospel is being undermined, it's being altered, much like it continues to be today. In the middle of this attack, Jude is saying, contend for your faith, contend for true faith, maintain your faith despite what's happening, strive for, expend effort into your faith. Don't just protect the purity of it, but protect the priority and its preeminence. This should be written for us today because this is what we struggle with daily. As we have temptations in our lives to water down the message. We have external pressure from our culture to omit portions. We have false teachers saying, oh, just allow the culture to dictate what God says. This letter should be written for us today. We have to daily, if you're in Christ, daily you are going to contend for your faith. Not just from external pressures, but from the internal depravity that we have. To say, I open this book up and sometimes I say, I don't like what this says. Because it grates against parts of me that I'm not willing to let go of. But I have to say, it's not about what I want. It's about what this says. I must contend for my faith. So it begs the question, how do we do this? Very simply, how do we maintain our faith while striving against the temptations internally and externally to compromise? How do we press on against the trend we see? And Jude answers in verse 21, very simply, keep yourself in the love of God, church. That's it. Keep yourself in the love of God. Okay, Jude. That clears it right up. Like, let's go, Shakespeare. You haven't even written one chapter yet. I think you can maybe spend a little bit more time explaining that. Like, well, I'll just sit back down, grab your pen, Jude, give another two or three chapters on this, because that doesn't really make a lot of sense. If I say, okay, church, we did this whole sermon, we're ready to close up. We're ready to wrap up. And I say, all right, keep yourself in God's love. Okay, I'll go ahead and do that. I have no idea how. Just going to try to keep in God's love. It's not terrifying. If you're familiar with the teachings of Jesus, and most of these guys were, that's really not a hard statement to understand. Understand the church knew God's word better than we do nowadays. And if you take a look throughout the chapter 14 of John, like if you've got a Bible, just take your highlighter, give it to your child, and let them just color all of chapter 14. Because literally that explains the whole thing. Verse 15, if you love me, Jesus says, you will what? Keep my commands. Verse 21, the one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. And the one who loves me, Jesus, will be loved by my Father, will be kept in the love of God. I will also love him and will reveal myself to him. 23 through 24, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him. We will come to him, make our home with him. The one who doesn't love me will not what? Keep my words. You want to know how to keep yourself in the love of God? It's directly related to keeping his commands and to keeping his word. The keeping of God's word is paramount to staying in the love of God. We don't get to claim to be his beloved called children, but then live daily in rebellion, rejecting his commands, disregarding his word. See, it goes back to our first point, doesn't it? Jude's identity. If someone is a faithful servant to a master, that person will daily keep the master's commands. If he seeks to daily know what pleases the master, he will spend his life ensuring he knows the person's desires and expectations. And that's how it needs to be for us, church. Okay? You want to keep yourself, you want to contend for the faith? Keep yourself in the love of God. You want to know how to keep yourself in the love of God? Follow his commands. You want to know how to follow his commands? Rightly understand what your identity is, your servant. That's it. You want to live happy? You want to have joy? You want to have peace? Be a servant to Christ. Think much of him, think little of yourself. Think high of his word, think little of your word. Think great of his will, hate your own personal will. That's tough, because my culture says something else. Things in my nature say something else. I know, but you weren't given a nature that is divine. We have a nature that is fallen, and it needs to be renewed through Christ. So, church, it's simple. And if we can stand as I close this morning. Jude is saying, hey, guys, things aren't safe. People are going to try to lead you astray. It's going to sound good, but it's deadly. So he implores us, contend for your faith by staying in love of God, living daily under the authority and submission to Jesus. If you do that, if you daily die to yourself and you live for him, then, beloved, know that he who called you will keep you. He will protect you and your faith will endure. Contending for the faith means dying to yourself. I heard it explained once by a pastor. He said, Jesus stands, and the word of God is called a double-edged sword. And Jesus stands in front of us with a giant sword. And we stand at the tip of that sword, and he says, come to me. With every step that sword penetrates our heart, every step we take, it goes deeper, and it cuts. And it destroys that which is sinful in us. And it hurts. And we force ourselves closer as that sword, which is God's word, cuts deep, separating what is right and what is true from what is sinful and what is wicked. And we continue and we press forward until we are purified by God's word and we are face to face with our Savior. It's a call to die. But in dying, there is such a beautiful life that you have never experienced before. So, church, contend for your faith daily. It's going to be hard to do, but, church, it's worth it. Stay in the love of God by following his commands. It's not dead religion. It's not legalism. It's not following a bunch of rules. It's staying within the parameters of where love is telling you this is safe. Well, let me pray for us. Father, I thank you for the joy and the privilege of learning your word. I thank you that we are the called. We are your beloved. And that we are kept for you. Such a beautiful picture. If there's somebody today that is struggling with their own identity, that has been called things that are despicable, they've been heaped with shame and guilt that they've even placed on themselves, Father, reveal today to them that they are your beloved, that you are initiating a relationship with them. Father, penetrate their hearts in softness so that they can respond to you and be kept for you. I thank you for the honor, the privilege of teaching your word. Forgive me and have mercy on me and have grace in the church for anything that I've said that was not of you. If in my ramblings I have gotten off topic and confused someone here today, I would ask that you would work through my inadequacy, that when they go home today, as always, Father, let them speak highly of you and not about me. Let them remember you, not my words. Let them be excited to come back and not hear me, but hear you, Father. And continue to have mercy on me and grow me into a better pastor for these people so that I can continue to show them your love for them. We ask this all in Christ's name.